Hello everyone and welcome to yet another video podcast here on the War Bonds channel. If you don't know me and you're new to the channel, my name is Eric. I'm a locomotive engineer by profession, an avid model railroader, and just a lifelong rail enthusiast. And for those of you who've been here for a while, probably noticed that my voice is a little hoarse today. Feeling great, just one of those things, but I still wanted to get some exciting content out to you today, so I'm going to muscle through this no matter what I have to do. But one of the things that I wanted to say is that you've all been very kind with your comments and sharing your personal thoughts and your personal journeys within model railroading. And also, a few of you have given me some ideas about some things that I should do. So while this isn't necessarily a channel that I would call Amazon Echo, where we say, hey, Alexa, can you make this? I do take the ideas in consideration as what people ask me for and what they would like to see. So I do take those things into consideration and really try to think about, is this something that I'm interested in doing? Is this something that I can do? Because as I said before on the video podcast about the Rock Island caboose, it was something that I wasn't planning on doing. I never would have built a Rock Island caboose out of all things, but I did it. It was actually a fun project. I learned a lot from it. And I figure, you know what? That just boosted my knowledge, my experience, and helps to escalate things, other future projects, helps to escalate them because I've learned skills from that I can put in to something new. So with that said, I had a friend of mine named Vincent who said to me, hey, maybe you need to make a passenger car. And this was also on the heels of another gentleman named Frankie who left me a comment that, hey, have you ever thought about making an older passenger car? So when all these things came down, it's like, kind of the same way I felt when my friend challenged me to do the reefer car, but like, you just had to go and say something like that. So anyway, I decided that I was going to attempt to build a Santa Fe passenger car. Now, as I said before, I'm a Santa Fe guy, but also because I'm working on that GP60M, one of the things that I figured I could do is actually make a Santa Fe passenger car, because even in the days of, you know, the last days of the Santa Fe even, it wasn't unusual to see, you know, one or two business cars, you know, in a train, or see a business car either at the end of the train or right behind the power. So that wasn't something that was uncommon. So I figured even in my era, I could still make this happen. So that's what we're going to go for. So how am I actually going to start this project? Well, I actually have a set, an 8-car set of G-scale Santa Fe passenger cars that have been sitting in my basement for years that have not seen the light of day in quite a while. And over the years, I thought, should I get rid of them and sell them? But then I thought, no. Because I think for one, my wife would kill me because her thought, the last time I got rid of some stuff, which wasn't that big of a deal to me, but I got rid of it to a young friend of mine named Owen. I had some old HO stuff that I hadn't used in years and probably close to 20 years. So I actually handed that stuff off to him because he's a very enthusiastic young man, and he's really trying his best to learn his skills and everything. So I thought, you know what, instead of this stuff sitting in the way in boxes, it's good stuff, and give it away to him. But as far as this G-scale stuff, no, I would probably kick my own self in the butt if I got rid of it. But here's where it actually came in handy. So 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 this is a G-scale sleeper car. So what I did is I took this thing, and this is so cool. Modern technology is wonderful. But I took this, I laid it down on my floor, in fact, right in front of where I'm sitting here, took my iPhone, put it up above it, shot a picture of it, and then took that picture, put it in Photoshop. I expanded the length of the car to 85 inches. So, because these are 85-foot cars. So, expanded that, saved the file, took it to FedEx office. They actually printed it out for me. And, yeah, it was like about, what, by the time it was all said and done, this car is going to be about 7 feet long. So, it's going to be a huge car. So, anyway, that's what we got going. So, as soon as I had those drawings made, I went to my favorite hobby store, Menards. And, oh yeah, my bill was, my bill was a little obscene. It was a little bit more than I thought it was going to be, but okay, once I got everything paid for, we're out the door. And, oh yeah, let's get this started. So, I'm going to, I did a little bit of work already. One of the things that I kind of wanted to do, kind of give the effect here, is if you watch any of those daytime shows, if any of you are around in the day, and I don't even know if she's still on it. Rachel Ray was one of the daytime people that I'd see. But anyway, they'd go into the kitchen and they'd make something. They'd making some kind of quiche or some kind of, chicken cordon bleu or something like that. And they bring somebody in and say, well, this is how we're going to make it. So first we take our chicken, we do this, we do that, we add this, we add that, we put some egg in it, blah, blah, blah. And then we put it in the oven. And all of a sudden, as soon as they put it in the oven, they're reaching into another oven and they're bringing out the finished product. Like, okay. So, I guess it gets the point over. So I thought, you know what? If they can do it, I'm going to do it. So in a few minutes here, I'm going to show you some parts that I have already put together, which are going to be one of the car ends I put together. But I'm also going to show you how I'm going to put the sides of the car together. And as I mentioned, the Rock Island Caboose, and I don't know that I mention it as well for you to really totally understand how I made everything, how I made the size of that caboose to where my window spacings were nice and even, the windows were nice and crisp and everything. So I'm going to basically be showing you the methods that I learned by doing that caboose, which is what's given me the confidence to say, like, oh yeah, I can do this passenger car, no problem, at least the sides anyway aren't going to be too difficult, but the roof line and the ends, you know, getting that nice, even, rounded roof line, yeah, that's definitely going to be a challenge, but just slow and easy is the way we'll work this. So anyway, we're going to go out, and I'm going to, at least for the sides, I'm not going to actually do all the gluing work and everything, because that's probably going to take a couple hours. It's going to be way too long, but I at least want to show you what I'm going to do and how this is all going to go together so that you get an idea. So I will certainly break this video into a little series, especially since, like I've said before, the GP60M project is just slightly on the back burner until I can make it down to Texas, which will hopefully be in the next month or two. My friend Charles has got a lot of parts fabricated already, and it's just a matter of me bringing everything down there and just getting this whole thing together. So, it's not forgotten by any means at all. So it's just slightly on the back burner, but in the meantime, you know, we're going to try to do, something that's fun. And I think that doing a passenger car is up the alley of a lot of people. So, I'm excited about this, and I hope you find the excitement of it as well. So, let's go out to my yard where I've got a table set up and got everything laid out, and we'll show you how we get this passenger car started. Okay, so we came outside and my daughter's here to assist me here, so we're just actually gonna start out by unraveling the drawings here so you can actually see exactly how big this car is. This is gonna be our 7-foot cars here. So you can see between my daughter and I, it kind of gives you the size perspective here, which she's good at that since she was in a picture of my reefer car when we first put it on the tracks. But yeah, so this is gonna be a pretty big car here. So anyway, we'll just start it with some of the parts that I put together already. I'll show you those, and then I'll show you exactly how I built them with the secondary parts, and we'll start with the ends of the car. Okay, so we're gonna just start from right to left and just talk about what we got here. So anyway, as you can see my hand here, you can see exactly how big this drawing is. So yes, it is actually a drawing, and just like I did with the original car sides, I actually shot a picture of the end and had that blown up, and I just actually took some scissors and a straight edge and cut as close as I could to just get the picture the way I wanted it. So it actually looks like there's an actual car in here, but this is just a paper picture. So that's what we started out with, just to get our basic size measurements. And then, even though I skipped ahead a little bit here, but I actually made 4 pieces here that were just a little, just a hair above 10 inches. So once I did that, I actually went to the drawing, and actually I guess I can show you here. So let's just say this is just a straight piece here. So I actually went to the drawing, or took the drawing, and actually put it on top here, and then took a pencil line to draw the curvature, which gave me this little template here. So which gave me this template here. So then what I was able to do was then do the same thing where just put the tip, well, turn this over again, sorry about that. So I was able to take the template and do exactly what I needed. And I did that with all 4 pieces. So now after I had those pieces, I actually took the bandsaw and tried to get as much of a curved cut as I could. And then I used my table belt sander and actually rounded things up. So once I finished up there, I took all 4 pieces and tried to give them the same curvature. So this is why everything is split, because as I said in another video, I wanted total symmetry. So therefore I know that when I put these 2 pieces together, you know, they're gonna be just right. Yeah, they're gonna be just right. So that's one of the reasons I split them up like this. But now, if we take everything, we put it on top here. Okay, This is what we're looking at right here. This is why I have them cut, is because I wanted to actually have the opening here, but I also wanted to cut these two halves so that they're perfectly symmetrical. And everything actually worked out okay. But now we go all the way to the left here. So this is actually one that, the one that I actually did yesterday. And don't mind the marker lines on there, but this is how we got everything together. And then once I glued everything together, I actually used the clamp here to hold it together. So this is the next day after doing it, and everything actually came out pretty good. Okay, so now we have two boards here. So this is going to make up the bottom side of the car. This space in between is where the windows will go, and this is the top, and then of course the roof curvature will start from here. Okay, so you're still kind of confused. Okay, so I'm going to show you here exactly what we have here. So being that my table is actually a lot shorter than the boards themselves, we're still going to show you a good example. So we're just going to start in the middle here. Okay, so I have L7 on here. So that's just, it's nothing other than just a reference for me. So because there are, you know, two sides of it, and I have two drawings, so what I did is, this is the side where the door will be on the left side. But if you flip the car over, the door will be on the right side. So hence, everything for the left side has an L on it. And let's see here. Ah, there we go. Everything for the right side has an R on it. So then, of course, if we start here, we'll have L1, then the space, L2, L3, L4. But these are actually referring to the spaces between the windows and not the windows themselves. However, I do have a spacer block that I cut out specifically to represent the actual size of each window. So, or at least most every window. There are a few that are a little bit shorter than the normal, but for the most part, on this particular car that I'm doing, they're all about this size here, most of them. So we start there at L7. Okay, put a window spacer there. And okay, actually, let's go this way here. Okay, so this would be a window right here. Okay, we have L8. Let's see. Now, when I'm actually doing this, I'm actually going to be gluing everything in together. So even if everything we're doing here doesn't come out perfect, that's fine, because everything's not being glued in yet. All right, so there we go, L9. Okay, L10. All right. Let's see. Let's see, there's an L5 right there. Okay, here's an L6. So let's go this way here. So put a window right there. Go L6. And then L5 right there. Now, also keep in mind that I have not actually done any kind of sanding work on any of these pieces here. So yes, there are a few little gaps there. And one of the things that I've had as a kind comment from a couple people is that, wow, you know, every time you do something, it looks great. So I just need to sand a little bit more on this stuff, but otherwise everything will come out just fine. Okay, so now as you can see, I put a couple more pieces in off camera, and my daughter actually came outside, so I'm gonna recruit her to actually help me put this together. Okay, so you wanna push that, push this whole piece onto the top of those blocks there. Just keep going. Keep going. There you go. Okay, so now you can see how we've actually got the side of the passenger car together. Now, obviously, as I said, there's a lot more work that needs to be done, and it's probably, knowing how slow that I work, probably going to take me at least a good hour and a half, 2 hours to put everything together here. But that means that I place each individual piece, make sure that it places well, and then I give the glue a little bit of time to dry so that when I put that window spacer in there, it's not going to start moving pieces out of place. But yes, this just gives you an idea here. And like I said, my table surface isn't the greatest, so yes, you're probably going to see some gaps here, but anyway, that just, you know, like I said, gives you an idea of how everything is going to go together. So there you have it. So that's how you can put a passenger car side together, or even in the earlier case, a caboose together, and have clean windows, and I don't have to worry about trying to take a jigsaw or something like that and try to individually grind out every individual hole. And unfortunately, when you do it, they're probably not going to be very clean anyway, and then you got to file and everything. No, that's just too much. So this is the way we're going to do it here. Well, I hope you've enjoyed this introduction to the start of this passenger car project. Like I say, I've never done one of these before, so it's definitely going to be quite the challenge, but so far it's been fun. So far I haven't said too many unkosher words yet about it, but I'm sure the part that I'm fearing the most is that roof line. But one of the things that I've noticed, I've been looking at numerous pictures, and as you can see on the car here, it's got skirting all the way across, and then it raises up over the trucks and then back down on the car ends. Now, I mean, let's face it, working with wood or just doing any kind of scratch build project like I'm doing has its set of challenges. So it looks like in later years, the skirting actually disappeared. So I'm still trying to debate whether I want to put the skirting on or if I want to leave it off. But I suppose really if I leave it off, number one, makes it a whole lot easier than have to create the skirting. But number two, it also makes the car more modern so that if I do run it behind that GP60M, it's actually not going to, you know, they'll be in the same era, because Santa Fe did keep a lot of cars, well, maybe not a lot, but several cars for their business car fleet. So it would make it a little bit more accurate in that way. Now, for those of you that might be, you know, diehard Santa Fe fans, you know, I mean, I consider myself that, but there are so many people that are much more knowledgeable and much more in depth about their knowledge of the Santa Fe. So I think that this car is accurate. I did find a picture, you know, that I showed you earlier that does seem to be an example, prototypical example of this window arrangement here. So, but oh my gosh, there are so many different variations of these cars. I don't know how Pullman kept track of all of them, but I mean, and that's just for the Santa Fe. But now go to the Pennsylvania, go to the New York Central, go to the Milwaukee Road, the Union Pacific, the Southern Pacific. You know, it's just, it's crazy. But nonetheless, I got a good start. I'm still trying to figure out how to do the fluting on the sides here. However, there are some cars that are smooth-sided cars and that aren't even silver. But because of the fact that I started cutting parts out for this arrangement of windows, this is called a 10-6 sleeper. So you've got 10 roomettes and then 6 deluxe rooms. So that's why I pretty much have to, you know, I started off on one journey in one direction. So I pretty much have to keep with it unless I want to start cutting more parts to make a different window arrangement, which I don't want to do that. I've already done enough as it is. And even though it wasn't bad, but it's still work, you know, it's quite a bit of work, but at least I started out with something that I can actually see and I can go to and I can reference. And that's the biggest thing that I want to do. So there's a number of things that, you know, we'll be talking about. I'm even still trying to figure out whether I want to go through the hassle of taking this car apart so I can at least kind of get an idea of the interior in here. Now, I know that when I've looked for pictures of, you know, Santa Fe passenger car interiors, it's really hard to find. And I think trying to do something like this is going to be even more difficult than, you know, trying to locate a Rock Island caboose, you know, like I was trying to do. But there's a few of these cars around, I'm sure, just not sure where, but chances are it would be a very, very, very long journey to get to where one is. And being that I'm doing this for myself, okay, I'm not that enthusiastic about it or that gung-ho. So either way, I will do something that will make this car really cool. Now, one of the other things that I'm still kind of debating as well is that I would love to actually make this a car that I can actually sit on behind the Jeep 60M, but I'm not real sure because if I was to do that, I could make the roof line, the rounded roof line, go to maybe about here and then make an actual depression, a flat spot to about here and then continue the roof line. So that way I could actually take a seat, put a seat on there, and then I could also put some pegs out there for my feet and, you know, be able to do it. But yeah, I don't know. It's like, well, if you're doing a sleeper car, especially, you know, you, as opposed to even a baggage car, if it's a baggage car, it might be a different story, but being that it is a sleeper car, I want to, you know, like a lot of you have mentioned that you love the detail that I put into things, and I want to keep the detail as fluid as I can. But another friend of mine named Deland also told me that, well, if you did that, you could also make a plug to put in there so that it still matches the entire roof line. So that is a possibility as well. But I don't know. You know, this is the start of the project. We'll see what happens. But anyway, that's it for now. But I appreciate all of you and all my current subscribers and all my potentially new subscribers, especially if you've stumbled onto my channel by accident. I'm glad to have you. Glad to have all of you that have been following me and commenting on the videos and showing support and encouragement. I truly appreciate it. So when I figure out what I'm doing, well, we'll have another video. But I'm enthusiastic enough about this project that I'm sure that I'll come up with something and there'll be another video soon. But in the meantime, if you enjoy this content, thank you so much for being here. And please, if you're new to the channel, I ask you to please like and subscribe. Thanks a lot. We'll see you in the next video.